If your kitty cat was just diagnosed with oral squamous cell carcinoma, the most common oral cancer that we see in cats, you've come to the right place. This is a really tough cancer. I hope you found part one where I talked more about the cancer, what causes it, what tests we do, and things like that. But in this video, we're going to talk about the different treatment options with an emphasis on palliative and supportive treatment options to focus on pain and nutrition. So let's dive in, let's break it down, let's talk about treatment options for cats with squamous cell carcinoma. So how do we treat these tumors, and why am I so pessimistic about treatment? The take-home message is, most of the time, treatment has not been shown to be beneficial. And if I'm going to recommend treatment, I want it to help your cat. So with surgery, we need 2 centimeter margins on both sides of the tumor. Guys, this is 2 centimeters. So if your cat has a 2 centimeter lesion and we need to remove 6 centimeters of tissue, that's often the whole face. It just is really hard. So if you just do a minimal surgery, the problem is they grow back. So we're often talking about moving the whole lower jaw, the whole upper jaw, you know, if the lymph nodes are enlarged, removing them as well. And they're just really big surgeries, and most of the time they still grow back, and it hasn't been shown to prolong survival times in what we call disease-free interval when the cancer comes back. And for the tongue tumors, surgery is not going to be an option. So surgery really doesn't improve survival time. Radiation, when you radiate the mouth, it can get a lot of acute side effects. And in general, the response has not been great. There is stereotactic radiation now, but again, waiting for new results to come back. The one kitty that I did when we first started doing stereotactic radiation at the hospital I was at did great, but I had other cats that have not done as well. So again, you know, it doesn't look like radiation is going to be beneficial. Whether or not stereotactic can be a better option yet to be seen. And then chemotherapy, so giving injectable or oral chemotherapy in general for a measurable tumor is not the best approach. You want to remove it with surgery or treat it with radiation. So in general, take-home message, surgery, radiation, and chemo has not been shown to be effective. Some people have looked at palladia, this oral medication. And again, the hard part with that is that you're peeling your cat 3 times a week and they have a oral tumor there. And that can be challenging as well. So these are some of the options that we're looking at. I'm really hoping that there'll be new data and new information to share. But at this point, most of the time for these cases, I am focusing on comfort, pain control, and nutritional support. So that's what I mean by palliative management, palliative support. Palliative is to palliate, to make the pet feel better. And so one of the things that we're often going to do is a non-steroidal anti-inflammatories. You're not going to be giving your kitty your non-steroidal anti-inflammatories or NSAIDs, but there are some that we can use with kitties. Kitties are very sensitive to non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, so we have to dose them safely. We have to be careful if they have pre-existing kidney disease, monitor their kidneys and their liver. And sometimes it can cause stomach irritation or ulcers. Often we're going to compound the medication to them. Your vet will dose it accordingly and monitor. And we're not only using non-steroidal anti-inflammatories for pain, but also it's thought to have an anti-cancer property, so it can help treat the cancer and palliate it. So that is one of the things that I typically recommend in my kitties with squames. Other pain medications may often be needed on top of that. So we're layering different pain medications with different mechanisms of action. Never going to give two NSAIDs, that would be dangerous, but we can use something in the opioid family, like butorphanol or something like that. And sometimes you're going to need to get these medications compounded, so they're in liquid forms to make it easy to give, because again, trying to give oral pain medications to a cat that's painful can be challenging. And then nutritional support. So again, one of the things that's going to be really important is weighing your cat on a regular basis and keeping track of their weight. A lot of these cats will need soft food, right? So wet food, canned food is going to be really important because it may be painful for them to eat. And the other thing to consider is feeding tubes. And I know when I say feeding tubes, there's often like a negative connotation. You're like, ooh, feeding tube, that sounds bad. But we can often have a feeding tube placed, and that can be a really good way to make sure they're getting their food because they're feeling okay. Otherwise, they're just, you know, now we're addressing their pain, but they're just not able to eat. And so there are esophageal tubes, E-tubes that can go into the neck, and then PEG tubes, which can go into the stomach. And so you can help get their calories in by feeding them through their tubes. And then you can also put their pain medications and any other medications in there as well. And then if they start to eat on their own, you just feed them less through their E-tube or their PEG tube, but you can still put their medications on there. So they sound a little bit scary, but a lot of owners are actually quite satisfied with them. So that is something that I will often have our internists place in our kitty cats with squamous cell carcinomas if they're not eating well. For palliative care, I can't underestimate the importance of appetite. And I talked about feeding tubes, but I also want to talk about appetite stimulants. And I have, of course, separate videos on there. But for kitty cats, there is a great relatively new medication called Mirtaz. It is mirtazapine, which is an appetite stimulant. And we used to have to pill cats or get it compounded to a liquid, but it is now in an FDA approved form for cats that's transdermal that you're going to put on their ears. And so each day you alternate ears, you'll wear a glove when you put it on, but it is approved for weight gain. So by using this medication, it stimulates their appetite and will help your cat eat and gain weight. You should go home with Mirtaz. You should ask your veterinarian about Mirtaz because cats need appetite stimulant. And that doesn't mean it's a bad thing, you know, that, you know, some people are really reluctant to use these medications, but it's just going to maybe give them that drive to want to eat. And pain medications can make them not want to eat. So they're on pain medications, they're painful. Those are things that tip the scale to not wanting to eat. So by giving them Mirtaz, you can kind of tip the seesaw a little bit back to help drive them to want to eat. So please ask for Mirtaz. It's my favorite appetite stimulant. There are other things you can do as well to stimulate the appetite. Check out my video on things you can do when your pet's not eating. Some of them are simple things like heating the food and other things like that. But Mirtaz is one of my favorite medications. And you don't have to pill your cat. And which are the cats that are the best ones not to have to pill? A cat with something going on in their mouth. Sometimes these cats with oral tumors will get infected and they'll need antibiotics, and that will make them not want to eat as well. So appetite stimulants are so important. Don't forget to ask your veterinarian about those as well. So that's really sort of a wrap on this challenging cancer. You know, the prognosis is not great. And most studies, the take-home message is 3 to 4 months, almost regardless of how aggressive we are or not treating them. So again, that's really why I've shifted into this comfort-directed treatment. And so if you do surgery in most studies, you know, radiation and or chemo, it's about 3 to 4 months. With that said, you know, I recently, one of my patients got about 6 months on the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory and palliative care. So there will always be ranges on every side. And I always hope that your pet is living longer and comfortable and happy, you know, and getting the care that it needs. There are some studies with, you know, longer term, better numbers with a combination of surgery and radiation and feeding tubes. There's one study where those kitty cats were out 14 months, so over a year, and just under 60% with 1 year survival. But again, the big problem with surgery is they're often coming, they're growing back, so they need radiation, and there's a lot of side effects with radiation. So if you're up for it, if you're up for aggressive therapy, definitely consult with a medical oncologist and a radiation oncologist. And this is one where you're probably going to want to see a board certified surgeon because the surgery is going to need to be, you know, a big aggressive surgery. So if that's something that you're interested in treating aggressively, you're going to want a team of specialists on your side to, you know, work together for this. Like I said, not my favorite cancer. I would be so ecstatic if I could hop online and tell you guys that there was a new therapy out there for this cancer. Or a better way to detect it earlier, because that is always my goal. Early detection, better treatment options. But stay tuned. I will let you know when we have more information. Thanks so much for watching. Please drop your comments below. I appreciate you checking this video out, and I hope to see you at the next video.